Компания US News Productions представляет. Война в воздухе. Производство Perpetual Motion Films. Текст от автора читает Монт Маркер. Фактор Аса.
The supersonic jet fighter.
Сверхзвуковой реактивный истребитель.
Millions of dollars worth of technology melded together into one of the most lethal packages ever devised. But the most important factor in its success is made of flesh and blood. Fighter pilots. Their job is air superiority. To protect friendly aircraft and to intercept and shoot down enemy aircraft. For these hunters in the sky, war is a contest, often boiling down to a game of one-on-one, kill or be killed. But what determines which aircraft goes down in flames? Technology, tactics, and training are key factors affecting the outcome. However, whether the game pits MiG against Eagle, Falcon against Flanker, or Tornado against Mirage, whether the pilot was trained in the United States, the Middle East, or Russia, the most important factor is often the individual in the cockpit, for whom this lethal joust is the ultimate test. In the words of Manfred von Richthofen, the legendary German ace of World War I, the quality of the crate matters little. Success depends upon the man who sits in it. For U.S. Air Force Captain Steve Ritchie, an engagement with two MiG-21s over North Vietnam lasting 1 minute and 29 seconds would be a moment when everything gels. Training, tactics, technology and luck would all play a vital role in the outcome of the battle.
July 8th, 1972. I remember Ritchie was flying the lead F-4 Phantom South Yen Bai over North Vietnam, and all of a sudden he picks out a voice on his radio and saying, Steve, 2 miles north, came from Disco, the control plane, 150 miles away over Laos. So this voice says there's two bandits on a heading that'll put them on Ritchie's rear quarter in seconds. Это означало, что 2 мига вскоре окажутся у Ричи на хвосте. Ричи мгновенно развернулся, увидел первый миг, но стал дожидаться второго. Когда это произошло, Ричи немедленно перешел в пикирование под углом 135 градусов, потом развернулся. Вдруг он заметил, что миг не находился там, где должен был быть. So Ritchie pulls into a wide barrel, rolling over and around the next 5 o'clock. С увеличенным радиусом поворота, fires and sends the first missile through the center of the MiG. The second one раздался взрыв. Второй миг прошел прямо через огненный шар. Второй миг занял подходящую позицию для нанесения удара по четвертому фантому.
So what does the MiG pilot do?
Ричи вновь изменил курс. Что делает летчик МиГа?
Ему удается обойти Ричи. Дебелвью,
стрелок Ричи, ловит МиГ в прицел.
Ричи
выпускает ракету Sparrow. Но ракета начинает рыскать, что-то случилось с системой наведения на цель. Тогда Ричи стал уговаривать ее. Он говорил, цель там, вон там. Неожиданно казалось, что она услышала его, совершила поворот на 90 градусов и попала прямиком в МиГ. Взрыв был просто потрясающий. Ричи удалось уговорить ракету попасть в МиГ. Невероятно.
Это были третий и четвертый МиГи
Ричи и Дебелл.
Ritchie became the Air Force's first ace in
Vietnam.
He would later say that July 8th mission was the most intense, the most exciting, the most perfect mission that he ever flew. One of those days when it all came together, a minute and 29 seconds to draw on almost every life experience that he ever had. Everything that was part of his makeup, training and education had to come together and work. And it did. As Ritchie said, few people ever get to experience a moment when everything gels, and it's a feeling that's hard to describe.
Unfortunately, few of the American pilots who flew in Vietnam would be able to look back on their combat experience with such fond memories. The high number of air-to-air losses in Vietnam was especially troubling when compared to the performance of American fighter pilots in past wars. American Air Force, Navy, and Marine fighter pilots had a number of factors working against them in Vietnam. Rules of engagement that required them to visually identify enemy fighters before firing upon them. A difficult task at the speeds of modern high-performance jets. Hit-and-run tactics employed by North Vietnamese pilots, who rarely attacked unless they possessed the advantage. Unreliable air-to-air missiles, which were the early Phantom's only weapon. Certain limitations in the performance of the Phantom, which could not successfully turn against the lighter, more agile MiG. Studies of the air war in Vietnam also concluded that the performance of the American fighter pilots would be significantly improved through realistic combat training, which meant thorough familiarization with the tactics and limitations of enemy fighter aircraft, especially in relation to the limitations of their own aircraft, and a return to basic training in air combat maneuvering, or ACM, the modern high-speed equivalent of dogfighting. But could training make aces? The Navy was the first American service to answer that question. In 1969, it established an advanced fighter weapons program, better known as Top Gun, to serve as a PhD course for Navy and Marine fighter pilots. The home of Top Gun, the Miramar Naval Air Station at San Diego, California, became known as Fighter Town USA. The program of individualized instruction in air combat maneuvering, weapons training, and adversary tactics paid immediate dividends. The Navy pilots began shooting down more MiGs over North Vietnam during a period in which the scores of Air Force fighter pilots actually declined. One of the first pilots to complete the course, Randall Duke Cunningham, became the first ace in Vietnam and went on to serve as an instructor at Top Gun. Cunningham summed up the basics of air-to-air war by saying, in air combat there are no points for second place. Top Gun was only the beginning. December 1989. American and Allied aircraft filled the skies over a hostile desert battlefield.
We were going with a full strike package. Transports, fighters, attack aircraft, everything coordinated by radar from the AWACS orbiting above us. I was with a group of F-15s running fighter escort and the AWACS controller warned us bandits coming up, fast moves. We knew they'd be flying the standard Soviet formation, equipped by ground control radar. So we punched in a course to intercept and headed after them. Two of our Eagles nearest the bandits went right in for target radar lock, but they started some random jigging and banking that surprised the hell out of us. We got into firing range about 10 miles and started pulling some high G turns ourselves, because enemy pilots were good. We took everything we'd tested, practiced, and used to train to handle the stunts these guys were throwing at us. Finally, we got a lock, fired the Sparrows, and released the Sparrows.
Their radar-guided AIM-7 Sparrow missiles did their job.
Radarной системой наведения сделали своё дело.
На земле компьютерная система слежения и оценки угрозы
зафиксировала поражение двух
F-15.
Хотя в небе не было ни инверсионного следа от ракет, ни следов взрывов. На самом деле не было выпущено ни одной ракеты, не было уничтожено ни одного советского истребителя.
The patch of desert this air battle has transpired above, although
arguably the most war-torn of any in the world, is at peace. And though it's the approximate size of Kuwait, it has no oil reserves to fight over. Здесь нет нефти и не за что драться. Это огромный бомбовый полигон базы ВВС Неллис, неподалеку от Лас-Вегаса в Неваде, в пустынном районе на западе Соединенных Штатов. Операция называется не буря в пустыне, а красный флаг.
Red Flag is the result of the U.S. Air Force's own evaluation of the air war in Vietnam, known as the Red Baron Report. But the Air Force also studied air combat of all previous wars, and while noting the success of the U.S. Navy's Top Gun program, decided to take things a step further. Established in 1975, Red Flag is a simulated combat training exercise developed to provide advanced training for Air Force aircrew, as well as for those of her sister services and America's allies.
также для летчиков американских союзников. Шесть раз в году на полтора месяца база Неллис становится страной под названием Редленд. Учения состоят из двух частей, каждая из них 32 недели, и в каждой из них принимает участие около 300 боевых экипажей и 1000 человек наземного персонала. Участники отбираются из ВВС США, ВМС США, морской пехоты США, а также авиации союзников Америки. В прошлом в этих учениях участвовали летчики из Великобритании, Франции, Италии, Канады, Саудовской Аравии, Германии и Сингапура. Обычно в учениях Red Flag принимает участие от 85 до 100 боевых машин, в том числе истребители, штурмовики и бомбардировщики, а также вспомогательные самолеты. Пока в небе разворачиваются учебные сражения, трехмерная компьютерная система, находящаяся на Земле, позволяет определить победителей и проигравших. But Red Flag is not a contest. Учение Red Flag — это не соревнование, и летчики, потерпевшие поражение, не убывают из дальнейшей борьбы. Учение Red Flag направлено на то, чтобы в выигрыше оказались все их участники. Они обретают уверенность и новое мастерство.
To simulate air-to-air combat,
Red Flag puts the visiting airmen designated the Blue Force against members of the 414 composite training squadron, known as the Red Force or Aggressors.
The Red Force's fighter planes,
the ones with the Red Star insignia, are not Soviet fighters, but Air Force F-16, хотя на них нарисованы красные звезды. Red Flag puts the visiting airmen designated the Blue Force against members of the 414
During some exercises,
в некоторых учениях эту роль берут на себя самолеты ВМС США F-18 Hornet.
Hornet,
более тяжелые машины с двумя двигателями, заменяют советские
МиГ-29.
Именно их использовала иракская авиация во время войны в Персидском заливе.
While Red Flag participants fire
в то время как на учениях Красный Флаг не используются боевые ракеты, отметки доставляются компьютером, участники других учений американских ВВС получают более конкретные доказательства своих способностей. Эти учения проводятся на базе ВВС Тиндал во Флориде и названы по имени знаменитого швейцарского стрелка Вильгельма Телля. Пилоты из американских и канадских ВВС ведут борьбу не только с друг с другом, но и с телеуправляемыми мишенями.
In the first competition profile, two fighter pilots test their skills against a BQM-34
Firebeam.
A remotely piloted aerial target. The Firebee's remote pilot steers the drone head-on against the fighter. As the Firebee is declared hot, the first pilot is cleared to fire a live radar missile. The remote Firebee pilot employs
violent maneuvers to evade the missile.
After the second fighter passes the drone, he maneuvers to fire an infrared
heat-seeking
missile.
The heater horns enter the Firebee's
exhaust and scores a
simulated hit.
The Firebee floats to Earth, ready to fight again another day.
Опускается на землю, чтобы подняться в воздух вновь.
Simulated air-to-air combat includes mock dogfights that pit pairs of competing pilots against four adversary fighters. Tactics are left to the discretion of the individual
aircrew.
The pilot's every move, including missile and gun firing, is monitored and recorded electronically, and the air combat maneuvering instrumentation, or ACMI, control room. In the ACMI, instructors watch computer-projected images of the air-to-air exercises flown at Tyndall. After the missions, they're reviewed and dissected by the pilots. The ACMI's three-dimensional replay of the dogfights gives the fighter pilots a unique perspective that enables them to see which tactics work, which ones didn't, and why.
А какая нет? И почему?
Methods like this enable the instructors to take their students step by step from basic combat flying maneuvering to the most complex and dangerous situations without the risks of actual combat. Without the risks of actual combat. The simulated air combat exercises and live fire scenarios of Williams Bell represent advanced techniques for providing fighter pilots with realistic air combat training. But the roots of adversary training can be traced to the very dawn of the dogfight in World War I. The legendary German ace, Oswald Bulke, who was credited with shooting down 40 Allied aircraft, used captured enemy aircraft to drill the pilots of his own hand-picked fighter squadron. Pilots flew the captured aircraft to study their capabilities and to compare their performance to that of their own planes in adversary exercises similar to those used today. In World War II, the German Luftwaffe established the Lozarius Traveling Circus, a squadron consisting of captured Allied aircraft. The circus traveled from unit to unit in order to familiarize pilots with the capabilities of their foes. The Luftwaffe's famed fighting general, Adolf Galland, said, "We could fly these enemy types ourselves, and we found out that we had usually overrated their performance. The circus proved a great success." Historically, adversary training of Red Flag and Top Gun has pitted Blue Forces using Western aircraft and tactics against Red Forces, whose aircraft and tactics emulate those typically employed by the Air Forces of the former Soviet Union. In 1991, the Soviet Union officially ceased to exist, and the Cold War, for all intents and purposes, ended with it. The dissolution of America's former arch rival, however, did not mean the demise of the real Red Forces. Throughout the Cold War, the Soviet Union exported, along with its aircraft, the same tactics and training employed by its own air force. So even as the political power formerly wielded by the Soviets has declined, countries such as Iraq, Syria, Yemen, North Korea, India, Libya, Algeria, and numerous states in Eastern Europe continue to represent the type of threat Western fighter pilots trained to fight against. Soviet fighter doctrine was revolutionized during World War II by Russia's greatest ace, Саша Покрышкин. Покрышкин shot down 59 German fighters during the war, but far more pervasive was the influence of his leadership and contributions to aircraft design and tactics. Soviet fighter pilots had been trained to fight only in the horizontal plane, flying parallel to the ground. But Покрышкин showed them how to use the climbing spiral for evasion, and the snap roll to quickly reduce speed and force an overshoot by pursuers. Покрышкин also studied the strengths and weaknesses of captured German aircraft, and fought with utter fearlessness.
Он не знал, что такое страх.
Before going into battle, Покрышкин often tuned his transmitter to German frequencies and challenged them, saying, "Beware all German pilots. The ace Покрышкин is in the air." During the Cold War era, the typical Soviet fighter pilot was the product of a rigid system, under which military orientation and training began in preschool and continued with enrollment in military youth groups, camps, and sports competitions, up through mandatory conscription at the age of 18. Tactical training began at higher aviation school. Overall, Soviet strategy tended to stress quantity over quality, mobility and ruggedness over sophistication, and standard answers to tactical scenarios. Interception of enemy fighters was ruled by ground control intercept, or GCI, which served to stifle the initiative of individual pilots. Traditionally, Soviet pilots even had to request permission from GCI to make a simple turn in flight. These methods were employed by Soviet-trained and equipped MiG-pilots in Vietnam. North Vietnamese pilots also favored hit-and-run attacks, refusing to become embroiled in lengthy dogfights if they did not achieve immediate success, and refusing to attack unless they held a tactical advantage. The shortcomings of this doctrine were illustrated in the Persian Gulf War, when Iraqi MiG and Mirage fighters, who were highly dependent on Soviet-style central-ized GCI,
quickly fell prey to coalition fighters after those facilities were neutralized by airstrikes.
После того, как эти наземные контрольные службы были нейтрализованы воздушными ударами.
However, in the years leading up to perestroika,
однако, еще за несколько лет до перестройки советская система обучения начала постепенно смещаться в направлении большей гибкости и инициативы нереалистичного боевого обучения, порой напоминающего американские учения «Красный флаг». Однако было одно важное различие. Упор делался на наступательные, а не оборонительные действия.
In Soviet doctrine, it's believed that since a fighter has no weapons to fire backwards, the best defensive move is always to turn towards the enemy, never away from them. Bold tactics like this engender a spirit of aggressiveness in Soviet pilots that inevitably leave them at a disadvantage in the highly fluid environment of air-to-air combat, where the line between offense and defense is often blurred.
Ironically,
the end of the Cold War saw many Soviet fighter pilots face their greatest challenge yet. Economic conditions and an uncertain future had a devastating effect on the pilot's morale. One officer complained, in the United States, a man in uniform enjoys great social respect. His welfare positions are high. In our country, this has long been a failure. A young military pilot averages between 240 and 250 rubles per month. This is half as much as a bus driver gets. These conditions raise serious questions regarding the effectiveness of Soviet forces should they be called into combat.
Советской авиации в случае новых сражений.
Although the Cold War is over, the Soviet legacy lives on in the aerial training and tactics that have been adopted by their former client states around the world. Another place where it continues is Red Flag, where Air Force pilots with red stars on their helmets strap into their F-16s to act as surrogate Soviet fighter pilots. The visiting Blue Forces pilot quickly learns that it does not pay to underestimate his opponent. Above all, Soviet pilots have a reputation for aggressiveness, and so do the adversary pilots in Red Flag.
Тех, кто исполняет их роль на учениях Красный Флаг.
Because post-Cold War cutbacks in U.S. defense spending forced the streamlining and curtailment of fighter training programs, the type of realistic combat training provided by Top Gun and Red Flag became more essential than ever. In fact, the driving principle behind Red Flag derived from an Air Force study of all previous wars, in which it was found that a pilot who survived 10 combat missions stood a significantly greater chance of surviving many more missions. Even in World War I, when pilots were often sent to the front with only 15 hours of solo flying under their belt, a high premium was placed on experience. British ace Ira Taffy Jones said, "It's wonderful how cheered a pilot becomes after he shoots down his first machine. His morale increases by at least 100%. The value of combat experience was even more vividly illustrated in World War II, when Allied fighter pilots struggled to overcome tremendous odds on both sides of the globe, fighting against pilots who had already had years of experience by the time Great Britain and the United States entered the war. Japanese fighter pilots had been blooded during the war in China. German Luftwaffe pilots in Spain. And were already past the initial shock and distress of being a novice in the cockpit of a fighter plane in the middle of combat. German and Japanese pilots, who were ordered to keep flying until they were killed or otherwise incapacitated, continued to rack up incredible scores of aerial victories. The highest scoring ace of all time, German Luftwaffe Colonel Erich Hartmann, shot down 352 planes over a course of 1,400 combat sorties during World War II, said Hartmann.
По словам Хартмана, тренировка необходима, но между настоящей войной и учениями огромная разница.
One jet pilot described an aerial joust between two opposing fighters as being like a knife fight in a phone booth. Mean, tough and quick, with no room for mistakes. Another compared it to a two-hour three-dimensional chess game played in 60 seconds. Although speeds, g-forces and distances have increased exponentially, the short duration of the average aerial battle is one factor that has changed little over the years.
Который не претерпел изменений за многие годы.
During World War I, leading Allied aces like Billy Bishop came to realize that when they were successful, the fight would be short. The burst of fire that killed would usually occur within the first minute of engagement.
This rule of thumb has held true over the years. The final outcome of a fight is almost always decided within the beginning 30 seconds, with the very first turn executed. Ironically, although mastery of air combat maneuvering is vital, fighter pilots are trained to avoid close-in encounters whenever feasible. Radar-guided missiles make it possible for intercepts to occur at distances that are beyond visual range. When an alert opponent successfully avoids these missiles, however, air-to-air combat requires the same basic skills that were required back in the days when seated opponents' flying skills were at a premium. The origin of vertical tactics can be traced to World War I, when German ace Max Immelmann sought a way to take advantage of a new innovation, the Fokker's forward-firing guns. Immelmann would swoop down on his prey from behind, fire at first through the pull-out, then use his momentum to pull up in a vertical climb. As the aircraft lost energy at the top of the climb, he would plummet into another slashing attack on the enemy plane. Although it was originally quite successful, the so-called Immelmann turn put the Fokker at a disadvantage when Allied aircraft with newer, more powerful engines appeared on the front. The lower pilot could climb after the Fokker and attack when it hung almost motionless in the vertical position, not under full control, and presenting an easy shot. Fighter combat evolved so rapidly during World War I that early pilots were forced to invent tactics as they went along. However, it quickly became obvious that certain rules applied in almost every situation. The pilots in German ace Oswald Brücke's elite fighter squadron were drilled in his rules of fighter combat, also known as Diktatbrücke. Among Brücke's rules were: secure all possible advantage before attack. Fire only at close range. Keep your eye on your opponent. Attack your opponent from behind. If an opponent dives to attack you, turn to meet him. Famous aces from every nation spanning the history of air combat have stressed the importance of Brücke's first rule: secure all possible advantage before attack. By employing speed, surprise, flying out of the sun, and various other factors. Royal Air Force Major James McCubbin, who shot down 57 enemy planes in World War I, always attacked at his enemy's disadvantage. If attacked at his own disadvantage, McCubbin would break from the combat. Though his sporting instincts went against shooting anyone down without seeing them, McCubbin admitted that nothing succeeds like boldness. Even Colonel Erich Hartmann, whose incredible record of 352 kills might suggest that he never avoided a fight, believed that when entering battle, if the enemy pilot is superior, he had no qualms about heading home to try again another day. But Brücke's first rule has probably never been as effectively employed as in Lebanon's Bekaa Valley in 1982, when the Israeli Air Force took on Soviet-supplied Syria. The Israelis deployed their fighters like these American F-15s in a mobile screen that ranged ahead of strike aircraft to spearhead a head-on forward hemisphere attack. The outgunned and outclassed Syrian Air Force was quickly overwhelmed. Many of the Syrian planes, like these Soviet MiG-21s and MiG-23s, were shot down before they had even retracted. In only 3 days of fighting, the Israeli fighter shot down 82 Syrian planes with no loss of their own aircraft. In the fighter business, individuality is encouraged to foster aggressiveness and initiative, but teamwork is gospel. Here again, the foundations of fighter doctrine can be traced to Oswald Brücke, who is credited with originating the concept of the wingman. Formations of fighters were broken up into pairs, consisting of a leader and a wingman, whose responsibility was to watch the leader's tail during attack, or press the attack himself when the leader was executing a defensive maneuver. Ironically, Brücke's death occurred when he collided with his own wingman, as each pilot attempted to gain a shot opportunity on an enemy aircraft. By forgetting his wingman's position, the master had ignored one of his own rules. During the early months of World War II in the Pacific, teamwork between pairs of aircraft provided the answer to the crisis facing American fighter pilots in battles against the Japanese Zero. The Zero could outturn and outclimb the F-4F Wildcat flown by United States Navy fighter pilots. But with the Wildcat's superior armor, armament, and roll rate, Lieutenant Commander John Thatch discovered that a pair of Wildcats was better than one Zero. In this tactic, which became known as the Thatch Wheel, two Wildcats attacked by a Zero would counterattack while executing a rolling scissors maneuver, leaving one pilot free to watch the other's tail during the attack.
Мог зайти в хвост противнику.
As tactics involving pairs of fighters evolved,
ever greater importance
was attached to the value of the wingman.
Все большее внимание уделялось
It was the view of Эри Хартман,
с точки зрения Эрика Хартмана, ни одна победа не стоила жизни ведомого.
He made it standard practice that any section leader losing a wingman for a kill would be disciplined by being forced to fly strictly as a wingman.
Должен был сам стать ведомым.
Navy pilots in Vietnam employed a variation of Luftwaffe double attack tactics known as loose goose, in which a leader and a wingman could, depending on the situation, switch roles as they flew, and thus a wingman would become a shooter. Flying at speeds near or above the speed of sound, communication between leader and a wingman has become more important than ever. To an outsider, the shorthand lingo of fighter pilots may seem like an exotic new language. But one key ingredient that makes it work is camaraderie. Pilots are encouraged to train, eat, and talk to one another as much as possible. In aerial combat, it's essential to know who you're flying with, their strengths and weaknesses, and how they will react to various situations. Whether a pilot was flying in the open cockpit of a Sopwith Camel, or keeping track of multiple bogies on the heads-up display of an F-16, no maneuver or tactic has ever been as important as being able to see the enemy before the enemy sees you. But resourceful fighter pilots must also be prepared to turn disadvantage into opportunity, and to be prepared for the unexpected. American ace Robin Olds found these rules to be true whether flying an F-4 Phantom over North Vietnam or a P-38 Lightning in Europe during World War II.
January 20th, 1944.
I remember Olds told me he was heading home in his P-38. He just happened to look back over his shoulder. A German 109 right on his tail, and it was firing every gun it had. Olds always said, if you don't see him approach, you're already in deep trouble. He didn't even have time to think. All he could do was yank the stick back as hard as he could and try and bank it around. But instead of pulling up, his plane starts shuddering and diving sideways. As if that wasn't bad enough, suddenly his canopy blows off. I mean, right off the airplane. It was like deploying a big airplane. The plane slowed way down real fast, and the German shot right by him. All Olds had to do then was roll his wings level, put the 109 in his sights, and bang, he had his third kill of the day.
Третья победа за
один день. Olds was up to his armpits and problems, and suddenly the advantage was his. And he sure as hell took it. Like Olds said, nothing is a set piece. You can count on it. No two fights are the same.
Не бывает только двух одинаковых боев. Никогда.
They have been called aces, eagles,
асами,
tigers,
тиграми,
fighter jocks.
Воздушными
жуками. Names that symbolize the aggressive spirit so essential for success in the fighter profession.
Для успеха в этой профессии.
Like many of the clichés, aphorisms, and stereotypes that have been reinforced over the years by fact and fiction, give an insight into the type of individual who would be drawn to the profession in the first place. They say, you can tell a fighter pilot, but you can't tell him much. Or, while other aviators climb into the cockpit of their aircraft, the fighter pilot straps his on. A competitive spirit seems to be one factor most commonly associated with fighter pilots. Before becoming a fighter pilot, American World War I ace Eddie Rickenbacker had been a race car driver. U.S. Marine ace Pappy Boyington,
ас американских ВМС Пеппи Боингтон, борцом.
Vietnam aviator James Stockdale, and numerous others had excelled in football.
Многие другие добивались успехов в американском футболе.
This drive to excel frequently extends even after they join civilian life. Many have gone on to become leaders in industry, politics, and not surprisingly, the field of aviation.
И что неудивительно, деятелями авиации.
John Trotty, a Marine pilot in Vietnam, characterizes a typical fighter pilot as generally the firstborn, politically conservative, family-oriented, a high achiever, and yet someone who's iconoclastic because they know that complacency is an implacable enemy. To Trotty, being a fighter pilot is a form of glorified madness. He marvels at the fact that pilots are paid money to do something they consider so much fun. While it appears that only a certain type of individual would be drawn to this profession, experience also bears out the fact that certain fighter pilots rise to the occasion, while others merely show up for work. Success in battle has often boiled down to a combination of factors, including, more often than not, being in the right place at the right time. The Battle of Britain in 1940 saw the fate of the British home islands resting in the hands of the Royal Air Force. Hundreds of brave fighter pilots rose to the challenge of the Luftwaffe against incredible odds. But even in this scenario, British ace Johnny Johnson observed a curious phenomenon as the pilots donned their gear for battle. According to Johnson,
pilots fell into two broad categories. Those who were going out to shoot,
те, кто собирался стрелять, и те, кто в глубине своей души понимал, что стрелять будут в них, на охотников и добычу. Перед вылетом охотники подходили к своим спидфайрам, перебрасывались пару слов с наземными экипажами, изучали карту, прогноз погоды. У них хватало времени, чтобы поболтать с товарищами. А те, кого и назвал добычей, запасались как следует. Они брали пачку французских франков, две, если можно, компас, револьвер, а иногда штатскую одежду, чтобы было проще выбираться, когда их собьют.
Их суета
напоминала мне некоторых деревенских жителей, которые проверяют, все ли включили в свой список, отправляясь за покупками в город.
Fortunately for Great Britain, the majority of RAF pilots were hunters. Throughout the history of air-to-air combat, the spirit of aggressiveness has proved to be a deciding factor. The words of some of the most famous aces of all time make this abundantly clear. The aggressive spirit, the offensive, is the chief thing everywhere in war, and the air is no exception. Only the spirit of attack born in a brave heart will bring success to any fighter aircraft, no matter how highly developed it may be. Fighting spirit one must have. Even if a man lacks some of the other qualifications, he can often make up for it in fighting spirit. I never went into the air thinking I would lose. January 17, 1991, 1500 hours. Captain Charles McGill, a Marine pilot on loan to the United States Air Force, escorts a strike package over southern Iraq. He leads eight F-15s during Operation Desert Storm.
McGill got a warning from the AWACS. Two Iraqi MiG-29s were flying patrol over the target area. So McGill took four F-15s ahead of the strike package to intercept.
Могил взял 4 F-15 и отправился на перехват. Неожиданно начался зенитный ракетный обстрел Земли. Для повышения маневренности Могил и те, кто был с ним, сбросили дополнительные топливные баки. Тут же заработала сигнализация, топливо на исходе. Но выйти из боя нельзя. В любом повороте он станет живой мишенью. Это все равно, что оседлать тигра, отпустить просто невозможно. Миги шли прямо навстречу, но F-15 ускорились, пытаясь использовать преимущество в высоте. Могил и пилот номер 3 поймали цели на своих радарах и выпустили ракеты. Миги разлетелись на куски.
Позднее он рассказывал мне, что сначала было страшно. Он о многом успел подумать. Но если разобраться, все было удивительно просто. Только правильно прицелиться, вовремя выстрелить, смотреть, как миг взрывается в воздухе, а затем сматываться.
To the layman, McGill's actions would hardly seem incredibly basic. But thanks to years of intensive training and dedication to his craft, they had become second nature. But what's just as important, McGill had experienced his first taste of actual combat and survived. In accordance with the odds, he went on to fly many more combat missions, and his squadron led all others in aerial victories. For the fighter pilot, just being a member of the world's most elite fighting profession generally means the fulfillment of a lifelong dream. Success, victory in air-to-air combat means the culmination of years of training, dedication, and pride in the fact that one has emerged triumphant in the most sophisticated, most lethal arena man has ever devised. He's given extraordinary opportunities to become the type of person that he is. He's basically force-fed as much information and capabilities as possible. Trained to fly in some of the best airplanes in the world. Trained on the most extensively technologically advanced systems like the ACMI. Small wonder, then, that in fact and fiction, fighter pilots are portrayed as competitive, cocky, even arrogant. And why not? The motto of the U.S. Navy's Top Gun training program says it all. Fight to fly. Fly to fight. Fight to win. That's what all the training is about. The one person is all set up for. The goal of the fighter pilot is to be the best. He has to be ready to prove it. Anytime, any place, against any threat.
Исполнительные продюсеры Стюарт Рекант и Мишель Фуро. Продюсеры и режиссеры Монт Маркхэм и Адам Фридман. Сценарий Джесс Саблета. Оператор Дэвид Штайнберг. Монтаж Скотта Пауэлла. Музыка Найджела Холтона.